JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for April the 22nd. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar continued trading higher against most of the other G10 currencies on Tuesday and during the Asian morning Wednesday. It gained the most versus NOK, GBP and NZD in that order, while it was found virtually unchanged against the yen, the Swiss franc and the euro. The relative strength of the safe haven suggests that investors' appetite remained subdued for another day. Indeed, turning our gaze to the equity world, we see that major EU and US indices were a sea of red, though the negative sentiment eased during the Asian session today. It seems that the driver behind the risk-averse mood was the same as on Monday, following the plunge of the main WTI contracts into negative waters for the first time in history. The collapse in the black gold spilled over into the June contracts. WTI hit a low of $6.55 a barrel to settle at $14.02 yesterday, while Brent's low was at $17.51 and its closing price at $19.33. The tumble continued during the Asian session today as well. Remember that yesterday we highlighted the stay-at-home measures worldwide due to the fast-spreading coronavirus resulted in much higher supply than demand levels, and this appears to be the case even after the OPEC Plus members agreed to cut production amounting to almost 10% of global supply. Now, with storage tanks getting full, holders of oil contracts prefer to get rid of them instead of taking delivery and paying extra storage costs. With regards to the May contracts, it appears that their holders were willing to pay in order to get them off their hands. Hence why the negative price on Monday, just the day before their expiration. As for our view, it remains the same as yesterday. With restrictive measures still intact around the globe, we cannot rule out further selling as demand remains subdued and storage space continues to diminish. Even if some nations decide to start loosening their lockdown restrictions, this may be a very slow procedure, and thus demand is unlikely to return to its pre-virus levels soon. What could change things is a bolder cut by Saudi Arabia and its OPEC Plus allies. Yesterday, the nation said that it is monitoring the market and is ready to take extra measures to stabilize prices. With regards to the broader market sentiment, apart from the slump in oil prices, it may have taken an extra hit due to yesterday's acceleration in both the coronavirus infected cases and deaths. This adds more credence to our view not to trust the long-lasting recovery in equity markets. Remember, yesterday we noted that just a day of accelerations may be enough to revive fears and trigger another round of risk aversion. You can see the graph here. We had a modest acceleration in cases and a decent acceleration in deaths, and so this may have been another reason for risk aversion. We believe that if indeed governments around the globe want to contain the virus, they should consider extending the restrictive measures. Even if they decide to start loosening them, the procedure should be a very slow one, as rushing into lifting the restrictions may result in a new wave of exponential spreading. Thus, we see the case for the global economy to continue feeling the heat, and it remains to be seen how deep the wounds will be. Now, the pound was the second loser in line, perhaps coming under selling pressure after the top official of UK's foreign ministry said that Prime Minister Johnson may stick to his December deadline for reaching a trade accord with the European Union. Today, we already got the nation's CPIs for the month of March. Both the headline and core rates declined from 1.7% year over year to 1.5% and 1.6% respectively, but the pound barely reacted, perhaps as the slides were in line with market consensus. In any case, the slowdown in inflation, further below the Bank of England's objective, may increase the chances of the bank to enhance its stimulus efforts to support the British economy from the coronavirus wounds. Later in the day, we get more inflation data for March, this time from Canada. The headline rate is expected to have ticked down to 2.1% year over year from 2.2%, while no forecast is available for the core rate. Now, taking into account that the year over year rate of the year-over-year rate of change in WTI fell further into the negative territory during March, we see the risks surrounding the core rate as tilted to the downside. Why? The difference between the headline and the core rate is usually volatile items like energy. So if the headline rate is to tick down to 2.1 from 2.2, the core rate may slide more. we believe that if we get the slowdown, if we get the slowdown, Bank of Canada officials are unlikely to, even if we get the slowdown, Bank of Canada officials are unlikely to act again in the upcoming gathering, because they have already announced an expansion of their QE purchases last week. So we believe that officials may decide to take the sidelines and monitor whether the already adopted measures have been having the desired effect on the Canadian economy. Now, as for the rest of today's events, apart from Canada CPIs for March, we also get the US Energy Information Administration weekly report on crude oil inventories. Expectations are for a 15.15 million barrels inventory build, following a 19.25 million increase the week before. The American Petroleum Institute report was not released yesterday. Instead, it is expected to be out tonight. As it is always the case, no forecast is available for this report. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock a.m. GMT time. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.